Hey brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick trying to make another video. Tired out, been ministering to people all day. Praise God for the ability to do that, the opportunity to do that, to serve some of his people, serve him by helping his people. Praise God for that. I just want to give a praise report for our brother. You know, lots of times when I'm dealing with people, you know, they've got lots of issues. But I thank the Lord, you know, when you get somebody like a brother, Brother Darren, his first name Darren, they tried to tell him he had these lumps in his lungs. It's probably some kind of cancer probably. And we prayed about it. I've been praying for him, and I know other people have too. And he's been praying, and, you know, and I just want to say it, just God bless the brother, because he said, hey, he's ready to go home to be with the Lord if that's what the Lord wants. You know, he's at peace with it anyway. Well, he had the x-ray. And it came back that he's all clear. He's not in danger of it being doing him in. And so it's dormant, whatever it is, whether it be cancer or something else, it's dormant in there. And so they're just leaving it alone. So he's good to go. So I just want to give the Lord praise for that, and I thank the Lord for Brother Darren's attitude about the whole thing anyway. The attitude that a Christian should have, you know. Paul said to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. You know, to live is Christ and to die is gain. So when you live as a Christian and you might talk to people and all this kind of minister to people, witness to people, you know, that's a sacrifice. But to be in heaven, hey, that's what it's all about, man. Being there with Jesus, literally there with Jesus, not just spiritually like we are now, but literally there. I mentioned that in the video, the last video. You know, we are spiritually born again, and we're spiritually seated with Jesus in heavenly places, far above powers, principalities, and all those things, as it says. But in the physical world, we still get sick. We still die. We still, you know, have temptation, and we still sin. You know, we all have fallen short of the glory of God. We all sin every day. It is not a matter of, of sin nature, or living in sin, but we all make mistakes every day. And then when you think you're perfect, then you're sinning with pride. So, you know, you can't win for losing in the flesh. As long as we're in this world, we will have tribulation, the Bible tells us. We have not the tribulation, but tribulation. We have troubles, we have sorrows, we have strife in this world. You know, brothers and sisters, like people trying to tell you that, we're all going to go through the tribulation because the Bible says in this world you'll have tribulation. Jesus said, but behold, I have overcome the world. I mentioned that Bible verse in the last video. Well, he didn't say every human that ever lived as a Christian will go through that tribulation, because it's been 2,000 years and all those people have died and they didn't go through that tribulation. We have tribulation in our lives, brothers and sisters. We have troubles, sorrow, and strife. Every person that's ever been born has died, except for those of us who are alive right now. Millions and millions and millions and millions of people have been dying over the last thousands of years since Adam and Eve fell. So, you know, there's suffering and sorrow in this life, brothers and sisters. We are living in a shadow. You know, we're like in the Matrix. And as a matter of fact, I used to say that when I first got saved and started in the ministry, I used to say, oh, we're in the Matrix. You know, we're living in a fishbowl. The real world is in heaven. And then I just discovered from Brother Jason Egroff, he had the writer on the Revelation News radio. He had the woman. It's a black lady who wrote the book that became The Matrix. And, you know, she wrote it as a Christian theme. I mean, it's a Christian theme. So we are living in The Matrix. We're living in this fallen world, and we're living in a shadow of things to come. Everything in the earth magnified, all the good things on earth magnified times a million is what heaven is like. You know, if you think you like pizza now, I'm sure the pizza in heaven, man, it's got to make Papa John's look like seaweed. But anyway, brothers and sisters, I wanted to talk to you about what the Lord has been talking to me about. Many things. And one of them is this, from Luke chapter 21, verse 25 through 28. Now, the Lord has been talking about the tribulation in this text. You know, I do lots of teaching out of, and mention this many times, Luke 21, 36, where Jesus says, watch ye therefore and pray always that you be kind of worthy to escape all these things and that shall come to pass, that's the tribulation, the great tribulation, and stand before the Son of Man. But in this text, what I want to read you is what the Lord was showing me yesterday. Excuse me, I've been drinking some soda. Verse 25, and there shall be signs in the sun and in the moon and in the stars, and upon the earth distress of nations with perplexity, and the sea and waves roaring, men's hearts failing them for fear and for looking after those things which are coming on the earth, for the powers of the heaven shall be shaken. And then shall they see the Son of Man coming in the cloud with great power, with power and great glory. That's the second coming at the end of the tribulation. That's the end of the 7 years. And when these things begin to come to pass, then look up and lift up your heads, for your redemption draweth nigh. He goes on to say, I was going to stop there but focus on one thing. You know, I always keep going a bridge too far, I guess, or a bridge not far enough for some people. Verse 29, and he spake to them a parable. Behold the fig tree and all the trees, and when they now shoot forth, you see and know for your own selves that summer is now nigh at hand. So likewise, when you see these things come to pass, know ye that the kingdom of God is nigh at hand. Listen. In the Old Testament, the fig tree is a reference to Jerusalem. He calls Jerusalem his fig tree two or three different times in the Old Testament. So Jerusalem was taken in 1967 in the Six-Day War, June 6, 1967. The next verse, verily I say unto you, this generation shall not pass away till all things be fulfilled. What the generation that saw the fig tree bud. So 1967, this is before I was born. Okay, it's already been, what is that, 46, 47 years ago, Six-Day War, Israel took back that Jerusalem. To me, that is the marker for this. And I mean, you know, that's not the final word on that. In my opinion, that is the marker when the final generation clock started, 1967. So that's already been a long time, brothers and sisters. You know, so the people who saw that and would remember it would have to be at least 50 years old. So anyway, brothers and sisters, that's not the point of my message. I want to go back to this verse 25. And there shall be signs in the sun and the moon and the stars, and upon the earth distress of nations with perplexity in the sea and waves roaring. Now, this is all going to happen during the tribulation, but as I've made videos and other people have, and of course it's in our spirits, we dropped two nuclear bombs on Japan, and that was not the tribulation. Hitler killed all these Jews, 6 million Jews, and tattooed them and all that stuff, and that was not the tribulation. So we can see, you know, that I've heard people say, like, if it's pre-trib, how can there be a nuclear bomb? Nowhere in the Bible does it say we cannot have a nuclear bomb before the tribulation. As a matter of fact, as I said, we've already had two detonated on cities. Japan in 1945, August 1945, 6th and the 9th of August 1945, two bombs, Hiroshima, Nagasaki, in Japan. And it wasn't the tribulation. It wasn't the end of the world. And I believe the United States is going to see that. As I've been making videos, and I feel in my spirit, as you know, it wasn't in my mind at all. And the Lord had led me and told me that the stuff from the Harbinger and all that was right on time. It's from Him. It's from God. And the Lord was telling me these things are going to surely come to pass. But when you see these things, that's the point. When you see these things, look up. For your redemption draweth nigh. Be sober, be vigilant, for your adversary, the devil, is like a roaring lion walking about seeking whom he may devour. Don't let the enemy devour you. Don't let the enemy steal, kill, and destroy you. Don't let him steal your oil. Don't let him bring you down. Don't let him make you a foolish virgin. Be a wise virgin, brothers and sisters. Be sober, be vigilant. Be prepared to be counted worthy to escape the tribulation and stand before the Son of Man. And I can't say it enough because I get new viewers. There, salvation. Nowhere who died and said salvation means you're going into rapture. Salvation is equated with a rapture. That's just what people presume and assume, that if you're saved, you're going into rapture. The Bible doesn't say that. Jesus told one church, Revelation 3:10, he said, because you have patiently kept my word, I will keep you out of the hour of temptation. It will come upon the whole earth. You know, that will try all the people on the earth. Luke chapter 21, verse 36. Watch, therefore, and pray always that you be counted worthy to escape these things and stand before the Son of Man. He didn't say, pray a sinner's prayer one time and you'll be worthy. He never said that. He said, pray always that you be counted worthy to escape these things and stand before the Son of Man. Now, how are we going to be worthy? What does it tell us? when Jesus, as I mentioned before, when Jesus wrote those letters, dictated those letters that John wrote down in Revelation chapter 2 and chapter 3, don't let someone, some greasy gracer, take hyper gracer, take one Bible verse out of context and twist it. I'm giving you multitudes of Bible verses. In Revelation chapter 2 and chapter 3, the Lord repeated over and over again, repent, repent, repent. And then he said to he who overcomes. He was talking to the church. He was not talking to the lost. Those letters are to the seven churches in Asia Minor and to us, to all the body of Christ, to the church. He who overcomes, will I let him sit in my throne with me? All those promises he made to all the people who would overcome in the church, not the world. He was talking to his church. One of those churches, Philadelphia, Revelation 3:10, he said, because you have patiently kept my word, or you have kept the word of my patience, in King James English, I will keep you from the hour of temptation that will come upon the whole earth. Now, how do you overcome? The book of Revelation, again, we turn to the Bible. What does it say? It says they overcame him by the word of the, by the blood of the Lamb, that's salvation, and the word of their testimony. Your testimony. I talked about this the other day. I can't say it enough, as the Lord has commanded me to earnestly contend for the faith. Your testimony. Your testimony. You have to have a testimony of your walk with the Lord. Jesus said, you will know them by the fruit they bear. As I've said in the past, why did Jesus curse the fig tree? Everybody gets caught up when you're talking about faith. Jesus talked about faith to move a mountain and all that. But he went and cursed that fig tree for a purpose, because there was no fruit on it. He went to the fig tree, there was no fruit, and he cursed it because there was no fruit. That's what he was saying the whole time. He told parables. He said, there was a man who owned a tree, and it didn't bear any fruit. So he said to the farmer there, the husbandman, you know, chop down that tree. It's burdening the ground. And then the farmer, his sharecropper there, his farmer said, well, you know, let me, you know, dig around it and put some fertilizer there and, you know, wait and see. If it still doesn't bear fruit, then we'll cut it down next time. The Lord was talking about Israel not bearing fruit. That's why he replaced them. Read those parables. In Matthew chapter 21, 22 and all that, when Jesus is in Jerusalem during the Passion Week, they call it, from Palm Sunday until Good Friday, he was there telling parable after parable of how God was taking the kingdom from Israel. Why? Because they did not bear fruit, and giving it to a people who would bear fruit. All of those parables are about that, even him cursing the fig tree. Okay, and then, as I've said the other day, the Lord's had me repeat this message in Romans chapter 9 and chapter 11. It says that they were the natural olive branches that were cut out of the olive tree for unbelief. But we, Gentiles, we the Christians, Gentile Christians, we're the wild olive branches that's been grafted in to the root. What is the root? Of course, it's Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and manifested, of course, in the Lord Jesus Christ. In the Lord Jesus Christ, all the way back to Abraham. That's the root of the tree we've been grafted in, brothers and sisters. Now, Paul says if God would not spare the natural branches, how much more would he pull out the wild olive branches? You know, so we should work out our faith with fear and trembling. We should be sober and be vigilant. You know, we're only walking on the water by faith, brothers and sisters. It is not any works of the flesh that's got you here in Christ. It's not the works of the flesh or anything of this world, but you're walking on the grace of God. And the only thing sustaining you is the grace of God and the word of your testimony, the blood of the Lamb, Jesus Christ, and the word of your testimony is sustaining you. Your walk with Christ. Jesus said, anyone who puts the hand to the plow and then turns back is not worthy of me. Anyone that doesn't take up his cross daily and follow me is not worthy of me. You know, Jesus said, follow me. Follow me and let the dead bury the dead. Brothers and sisters, you need to come out from the bondage of sin that you are. It's just like the children of Egypt coming out in the Exodus. You know, that the trumpet blast, a call has gone out. Behold, the bridegroom cometh. We are approaching, brothers and sisters, when all of these things is coming upon the United States. Just as it says in Hebrews all of those things that easily beset you. You know, let the crooked path be made straight. Stop, you know, straighten up the feeble knee, you know, turn your feet straight. You know, strengthen your bended knee, your crooked knees, your weak knees. You know, and don't be overcome, but run the race. Patiently run the race that is set before you. Hebrews chapter 12 is what I'm quoting from. Because in Matthew chapter 25, when the Lord is telling the parable of the 10 virgins, there's the 5 foolish virgins who run out of oil and the 5 wise virgins who have enough oil who make it into the marriage supper of the Lamb. And the word says, the Lord said that at the midnight hour, at the midnight hour, at the darkest point, the cry rang out, "Behold, the bridegroom cometh." Brothers and sisters, that midnight hour, the midnight hour is about to come upon this world. That darkest moment when this world will pass through the veil of a world that has known the light of God, even though we've been in a cursed world since the time of Adam and Eve. This world of man is about to pass through the veil of darkness, under the veil of darkness, and be birthed into the kingdom of Antichrist, brothers and sisters, for 7-year period, brothers and sisters. Night is coming when no man can work. Therefore, you need to work while it is light, says the Lord. You need to work while it is light. The day is far spent. The summer is gone and we are not saved. Anyone that follows me, the Lord says, you must count the cost. That's from Luke. I want to say Luke chapter 13. The Lord is just speaking to me. Anyone that wants to follow me, you've got to count the cost. You know, like if you start to build a building, Jesus said, and you don't have enough money to finish it, and there you've just wasted all your time and effort building a building and didn't finish it. Or like a general of an army, if he's going to come out and fight another army, he has to count the cost. Can I win this battle? If not, he needs to make peace with the adversary if he can't win the battle, or go out and win the battle. So you have to count the cost of following Jesus. That's a whole nother video. Brothers and sisters, you have to count the cost. O ye of little faith. O ye of little faith. O ye of little faith. You know, this is what the Lord is. I'm just flowing in the Spirit of God, brothers and sisters. I want to get out what the Lord wants me to say. O ye of little faith. O ye of little faith. Ye of little faith. Hallelujah. Have faith in God. Have faith in God. Has he not said it? Will he not do it? Man, God is not a man that he should lie. Now the Son of Man that he shall repent. Has he not said it? Will he not also perform it? Will he also not do it? Is he not also able to perform it? Brothers and sisters, the Lord is the righteous judge. He will judge righteously. He's coming with those eyes of fire, and he will judge righteous judgment. Don't be deceived. The Lord is not mocked. Whatever a man soweth, therefore shall he also reap. If you sow to the flesh, you will reap a whirlwind. If you sow to the Spirit, you will reap of the Spirit. Brothers and sisters, God is not mocked. Today is a day of salvation. Today is the day to make peace with God. I beseech you, which means I ask you, I beg you, I plead with you. Make peace with God right now. Let's pray, brothers and sisters. Let's pray. Let's pray. You know, if you're already right with God, pray with me for those who are not. There are people watching this video who are not right with God. Let's pray right now till we know that we know. Romans 8:16. His Spirit bears witness with our spirit that we are the sons of God. Let's pray. Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God, Father, we come before you, Lord. Lord, you said you sent your Holy Spirit to bring conviction of sin, Lord God. Oh, Lord, bring your conviction of sin upon us, Lord. Oh, Lord, deliver us from the evil one, Lord. Hallelujah. Father, we beg thee, Lord. We beseech thee, Father, in the name of Jesus, Lord God. Prayer, pour out, Lord. Pour out, Lord, a spirit of repentance upon your people, Lord. Lord, we can do nothing without you, Lord. Lord, it's all by you and to you and through you, Lord. We cannot even know you except by your Spirit, Lord God. Lord, you said it's not by might or by power, but by your Spirit, Lord God. Lord, all we can do is offer ourselves, Lord, as a living sacrifice, Lord. We come before you right now in the name of Jesus, Lord. You said if your people who are called by your name would humble themselves and pray and seek your face and turn from their wicked ways, our wicked ways, Lord, you would hear from heaven, Lord. You would forgive our sins and you would heal our land. Father, we just come before you in the name of Jesus, Lord. Lord, we've all sinned, Lord God. Help us, Jesus. Help us, Lord. We cry out to you just like Peter when he started sinking in the water. Jesus, help me. Save me. Hallelujah. Lord, take my hand, precious Lord. Hallelujah. Even as the song says, take my hand, precious Lord. Lead me on to the other shore. Hallelujah, Lord. Hear my cry. Hear my call. Hallelujah, Lord. Jesus. Guide my hand, Lord, lest I fall. Take my hand, precious Lord. Lead me home. Thank you, Lord. Take our hand, precious Lord. Lead us on, Lord, to the other shore, Lord. Take us, Lord, with you, Lord. Take us with you, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. It says you led the children of Israel across the desert into the promised land, Lord. Take us, Lord, by the hand. Lead your bride, hallelujah, into the promised land, hallelujah. Worthy and holy is he, hallelujah. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, hallelujah. The God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, hallelujah. Hallelujah, 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 Lord, hallelujah. Hallelujah, Lord, hallelujah. Yes, Lord, that we would fly away with you, Lord, hallelujah. And go away with you, our love, hallelujah, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord, into the most high, humble abode of the most high God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. Surely, Lord, you know how to deliver your children from the snare of the fowler, Lord. Hallelujah. Psalm 91. For the Lord shall snatch his people out of the jaws of death, hell and the grave. Out of the jaws of destruction shall the Lord snatch his bride. Hallelujah. And set us up on a rock. Hallelujah. He shall prepare a table for us in the presence of our enemies. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let hell be defeated. Let Satan be defeated and God exalted. Hallelujah. For the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Hallelujah. The Lord knows how to deliver those who humble themselves. He knows how to deliver those who are his children. Hallelujah. For the Lord is the Lord of Sabaoth, the Lord of the resurrection, and the Lord of the harvest. The Lord of the Most High God, hallelujah, is our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Blessed be his name. Blessed be his name on high, for he is great and mighty and worthy to be praised. Hallelujah. Bless his holy name. Blessed be his name, for his name is righteousness and holiness. And he is exalted, hallelujah, in his people. Hallelujah. For the Lord shall be exalted in this place. Hallelujah. Forevermore. Forevermore shall the Lord be exalted. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Is there no time? There will be no time that the creation will not worship and praise. Hallelujah. And honor the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. The Lamb of God, the blessed hope, the Lamb of God, the Deliverer, the Redeemer, the Rose of Sharon, the Balm of Gilead. Hallelujah. 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 Blessed Redeemer. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. King of kings and Lord of lords. Hallelujah. Glory is his name. Hallelujah. Blessed is his name. Exalted is his name. Holy is his name. Righteous is his name. Redeemer is his name. Hallelujah. King of kings. Lord of lords. Hallelujah. Blessed be his name. Yeshua HaMashiach. Hallelujah. My Lord and my God, my Christ and my King, my Deliverer, my Redeemer, my Salvation, my Healer, my God. Hallelujah. Blessed be his name. Hallowed be his name. Hallelujah. Forevermore and evermore and evermore. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Blessed are those who are invited to the marriage supper of the Lamb. Hallelujah. And blessed are those who sit down with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob to feast. Hallelujah. To the love feast of the King of Kings. Hallelujah. And Lord of Lords. Blessed is his name. Blessed is his name. Holy is his name. And righteousness goes before him. And exalts his people. Hallelujah in Jesus' name. Hallelujah, brothers and sisters. Blessed be his name. Glory be his name. Hallelujah. He's going to show signs and wonders and the stars, the moon, the sun, the moon, and the stars. Brothers and sisters, we're going to see, and the tribulation saints is going to see, New Testament miracles and Old Testament signs and wonders come together in the fullness thereof of the kingdom with the Jewish nation, Israel, and the church in the fullness thereof with the tribulation saints. Tribulation saints and Israel come together for New Testament signs and wonders of healings and salvations and all the things you see in the book of Acts. And then the nation of Israel with signs and the sun, moon, and stars. All the mighty things that God would do. Rain, calling down fire from heaven by the witnesses and all those things. God's bringing all those things together, brothers and sisters. God bless you guys. God bless you guys. God bless you guys. Even as the Lord had told me earlier too, I'm just remembering that the blood moons, these blood moons are signs in the sun, moon, and stars, pointing the way to Jesus. All things, all roads lead to Jesus. They don't lead to Rome. The road to hell leads to Rome. All roads lead to Jesus. All roads lead us to Jesus. And then there's only one road, one narrow gate into heaven. All those roads lead to the gate, Jesus, to Jesus. You must pass through Jesus. You must pass through Jesus. You must pass through Jesus to enter the kingdom of heaven. You must pass through the Messiah. You must receive the Lord Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. You must call upon the name of the Lord. You must repent of your sins and invite the Lord Jesus to be your Lord and Savior. And renounce all the kingdom of darkness, brothers and sisters. That's what the Lord is speaking to me right now. You must leave those things behind. Leave all those things behind. When you come to Jesus, leave the world behind. Leave all the things of this world behind. As the song says, the things of this world become strangely dim in the light of His wonderful grace. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Hallelujah. Turn your eyes upon Jesus, and the things of this world grow strangely dim. You know, the Lord before me, the world behind me. No turning back. No turning back. Hallelujah. With the Lord before me and the world behind me. No turning back. No turning back now, brothers and sisters. You put your hand to the plow. Don't look back. We're out of here. The kingdom of heaven is at hand. And we're out of here, brothers and sisters. Hallelujah. We're the last generation. Hallelujah. 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 The apostles would be provoked to jealousy to live in this day. The ones who walked with Jesus in His earthly ministry would be provoked to jealousy to be here, walking on this earth and participating in the rapture. Brothers and sisters, the resurrection of the saints. Blessed be His name. Hallowed be His name. Jesus is the only gate. He's the only way. He's the narrow way. God bless you guys. I love you guys. I hope we're going home soon in our time. Soon in the Lord's time. I hope it's soon in our time. God bless you guys.